Hey, man, did you hear? Your favorite Mighty Wings are back at McDonald's.
Say what?
Yeah, man. We should...
Word?
Yeah, man. That's what I was saying.
Wait. No joke. You serious right now? Are you for real, real, not for play?
Dude, are you done? Because if you're done, we can go get some.
Yeah. Let's bro.
Yeah, let's do it.
Get excited. Mighty Wings are back at McDonald's. Pair a 5-piece with fries and a frozen strawberry lemonade and get your Mighty Wings fix before they're gone again. At participating McDonald's for a limited time.
Blog Talk Radio.
Good morning and welcome to the Parenting Aces radio show on Blog Talk Radio's UR Tennis Network. I'm your host, Lisa Stone, and I am going to have to apologize for my voice today. I have this upper respiratory yuck that seems to be making its rounds, at least in the Atlanta area. Everybody I've talked to seems to be afflicted, and it's just kind of knocked me for a loop. But lucky for you, I have an awesome guest today in Bob Litwin, and Bob is more than happy to take over the mic and keep us going today and provide some much-needed information to all of us tennis parents, and especially those whose children are maybe struggling a little bit on the mental side of the game, maybe having some issues with results, maybe having some motivation challenges, or whatever else may be going on. And so I'm really excited to have Bob with us today. Bob has a new book out, and I'm going to invite him to talk a little bit about his new book and how our players, our junior players, can use the information Bob presents to enjoy their experience on the court more, to find the maybe internal motivation that they need to keep pushing to reach the next level, and just to have an overall better experience out there. So without further ado, let me bring Bob on the line. Bob, are you there?
Hey, good morning. Yes, can you hear me all right?
I can hear you great. Hello? I'm sorry, we are having such weird technical issues with Blog Talk Radio lately. I'm not sure what the heck's going on, but thank you for your patience.
Oh, okay.
And I'm not even sure. Are you there?
I'm here. Good morning.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
So I'm not even sure if we're broadcasting live or if we're in podcast mode to the listeners. I apologize if it's not going live, but at the very least, we are recording for the podcast, and that will be online at parentingaces.com later today.
So, well, don't worry. Hey, good morning. I'm sorry you don't feel well.
Thank you, and I will try to mute myself before I cough into the mic. But, Bob, I wanted to give you an opportunity to give a little background on yourself and your tennis. I'm really trying to limit the amount of talking I do today because I'm sure I'm not too pleasant to listen to today. But I want to give you, you know, a chance to talk a little bit about your background and the work you're doing in storytelling. So with that, I'm going to be quiet and let you talk.
Okay. All right, no problem. I'll be happy to do it. So I guess, first of all, what I should say is that I was a tennis teacher for, well over 35 years on Long Island. I was teaching kids that were obviously trying to do well in tournaments. The dream, of course, was to get a college scholarship, play on the tour. As we know, very few end up reaching those kinds of pinnacles. But it didn't change the fact that everybody was working really hard at getting the most out of their game. And then I was working a lot with recreational athletes who, I mean, we didn't have ratings at the time other than beginner, intermediate, advanced. But I guess we were working with people that were 2-0s up to 5-0s and 5-5s. And I had this very interesting experience of, in the early years, not really seeing the kinds of results that I thought that I ought to be getting because I had, I thought, decent information that I was giving out during lessons. But I was confused why people in general weren't really able to execute these, what I thought were great plans, like to go for it when you were under pressure or to play steadier when you were maybe in the lead, or, you know, whatever the strategies were, or whatever techniques I was teaching. And people would come back and they would say to me, hey, it's not that easy. You know, you say when you're down, break point, play aggressively. But it's not that easy. And I was not really competing myself at that point. I hadn't competed since I was in high school, and even then it was a sort of a minimal experience. I was a basketball player playing tennis in the off season. I went to Michigan. I wasn't good enough to make the team, so I wasn't a player, but I was giving advice about tennis. I was a teaching pro. So I decided a good move would be to play some tournaments. So in my late 20s, early 30s, I entered a couple of tournaments, only to find out how difficult it was to do those smart things that I was telling people to do. And I lost to people not as good as me. And that seemed to be something that people were complaining about in their games. So I decided to make it my journey to get better at those things that interfered with me playing the way I was able to play. And I think that was sort of thematic for people, that they would come for lessons, and of course they wanted to get better. But before that, they wanted to play the way they seemed to be able to play when it didn't count. And I would hear that from parents about their kids as well. Gee, Johnny's like so good in the drills, and on Monday night over at the club with the pro, he doesn't miss a ball. And then he gets out to play a match, and he doesn't play that way. He gets uptight. He gets worried. He's emotional. All things that I discovered when playing were difficult to get on the other side of. So slowly but surely, I developed this idea about being more focused. And this was in the maybe the early 80s. Focus wasn't really that common a word. And I decided to teach people focus more than teaching them about strokes and strategy. That I felt that if people were able to pay attention really well to what they were doing, they would likely be able to execute. So for me, again, I was still losing to people not as good as me, but making progress. But the long story short is that it took me about 5 or 6 years before I started to win in the way I thought sort of matched up with the way I was able to play. And after doing well in Eastern tournaments, I played nationals. I didn't win for 5 years in nationals, and then I had a breakthrough. When I was 40, I won the 35 and over national championships. Later that year, I won the 40 and over national championships, and I was on my way to what ended up being like, for me, it was like a remarkable career of senior tennis. By the time I was 55, I was number one in the world, the 55 and over, and since that time, I've won a world championship and 18 national titles, 8 Senior Davis Cup, and I was fortunate enough to be inducted into the Eastern Tennis Hall of Fame with all kinds of tennis luminaries like Don Budge, Billie Jean King, John and Patrick McEnroe, Arthur Ashe, Althea Gibson, and I was the first non-tour player to get in as a player, just a senior tennis player. So that's my background in terms of playing and how I developed what became a model of coaching that was based on having better stories. So is that a good intro, Lisa? You want to?
That's a great intro, and it's a great intro. And I want to just point out to my listeners that, you know, this is, I think, why most of us get our kids involved in tennis, is so that they have stories like yours when they are in their 40s, their 50s, their 60s. Not so much, you know, it's not solely about the accomplishments in the 12s, the 14s, the 16s, but as importantly, it's about the accomplishments in the over 40s, over 50s, over 60s, and, you know, to be able to have a skill that translates age across all ages and can take you throughout your life. I mean, what a phenomenal thing to have. What a phenomenal gift.
Well, I would say that, you know, we people who are on the teaching side of tennis we often give parents and kids the message that you're learning incredible skills by being in a sport like tennis, an individual sport where you have to be self-reliant, you have to pick yourself up when you're down, nobody can do it, no matter how much instruction you've had, you're out there alone for the length of the match. It's very rare that you're coached during a match. It's only in Davis Cup and Federation Cup, basically, that you can get coached. I know women's tennis has some coaching, and collegiate tennis, high school and collegiate tennis, but most of the time you're playing, you're on your own. So these skills that we're encouraging the kids' parents to support, these skills are truly life skills. They hear it. I don't know if they buy in that much, especially the kids. They're not thinking that much into the future. But especially for the parents, it's so important that they know, as they're encouraging their kids to do well, that so much of the emphasis of their own post-match evaluation, it'd be really helpful if it had to do with how the kids are doing with the skills more than the results they're getting from these skills. Because let's face it, every time you walk on the court, you're going to win or you're going to lose. And you can play great and you can win. You can play great and you can lose. You can play badly and win. You can play badly and lose. Those are four of the possibilities of what happens, even if you're the best player. I mean, the other day, Novak lost to Andy Murray. He hasn't lost to him in a long time. And there it was. It's not that he's a bad player. It's that that's one of the experiences in the game. So I guess I want to say to all the listeners, please listen to the coaches when they talk about the value of these life skills. I can tell you that personally, when I first started to compete, it was all about winning and losing for me. But my experience was when I would lose, I would be very unhappy, even if I played well. And when I would win, I was never as happy as I thought I would be, because I wasn't winning because I played that well. My mind was like, well, they didn't play that well, or they had a key double fault. And I even remember in the semis of the World Championships, the year I won it, that I played somebody I'd never beaten, and he had a double fault at 5-all, deuce, at 5-all. Deuce, which gave me the opportunity to break his serve to then win the match in the next game. And I said to him, he's a dear friend of mine, Brian Chaney, who's probably the best senior player in my age group in the world, I said, I can't believe you double faulted. I mean, I thought you were like, you never do that. And he would just smile at me and say, look, this is the game. None of us are perfect. So going back to the idea of the skills, I trained a lot, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, to get the results that I aspired to. And I was fortunate to get those results. And then later in life, I had a very a difficult period in my life where my wife was sick. It was a really tough period. And what I realized was all the training that I had done to be good physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually in order to win in tennis, it set me up to be really great in what turned out to be the toughest match of my life, which was dealing with illness in the family. And I felt blessed that I had had tennis that provided a training for me to be good in adversity. And life is filled with bumps in the road, adverse situations, whether we're kids, young adults, young parents, or aging senior athletes. If we can learn from our tennis experience how to deal with these difficult situations, then tennis has given us a gift that's a lifetime gift. And this is the message that I feel is very difficult to communicate. Well, not to communicate, but for that communication to be received effectively. Does that make sense?
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And it's interesting, Bob. I watched yesterday Facebook COO Sheryl Sandberg gave the commencement address at Berkeley this past weekend.
Sure.
And right. That was the message of her commencement address, was how facing adversity and how you react in the face of adversity defines you as a person and shapes you as a person. And for my listeners out there, if you Google her commencement speech or the Berkeley commencement speech for 2016, you'll find it. It's about 15, 20 minutes. So worth listening to. I just want to highly recommend that people give it a listen. But it's so true that, you know, life is filled with challenges. And, I mean, you open your new book with exactly that, you know, your brutal honesty about the severe challenges that you were facing in your life with your wife's illness, your subsequent passing, your own health issues and how you were dealing with those. And what a difference it made to shift your mindset and, as you call it, to change the story that you were telling. And I'd love for you to expand on that.
Yeah, sure. I mean, so I woke up one morning and I was feeling like I had nothing left to give. I had lost my wife and I was at risk for a massive fracture of my hip. I had already had hip surgery that had failed, and the doctors had told me that you need to have a brand new surgery, you need to replace what was done. We have to start all over. And I just kind of felt like, I can't take this anymore. I can't. I mean, it's like, it's been a brutal 3 years. I have no energy left for this. I don't want to go back into a hospital and so forth and so on. And I was basically telling myself a story that was not a very good story. I mean, it was true that I was fearful about going back for surgery. I thought I would come out old. I thought I was going to be alone in my life. I didn't know who would take care of me after surgery if I had it. And it was just, I kept running that story for a couple of days, and it immobilized me. And then one morning I woke up, and while looking in the mirror, I heard the voice, my wife's voice. And she said to me, "Well, what would you tell a client, Bob? You always seem to have the answer for other people." And I looked in the mirror and I answered that question with, "You need a better story. You need a new story." And that is what I always say to clients that I work with in the business world, sports world, in any world at all. And I immediately sat down and I wrote a new story, a story of hope and optimism and of who I needed to be. And that story was one that was more of, I've been through surgery once. I'm a master of rehab. I'll be able to do it again, despite the fact that doctors say I might not be able to play again. I will be back on the court. I will get back to where I was. I will not be alone in my life. I have too much love to give, and I have too much love that I'm looking to receive. Somebody out there will come into my life. I have friends and family who can take care of me during this period of time, and it mobilized me. Now, of course, when I write a new story, it's not where I really am. It's not who I am. It's what I aspire to be or where I want to go. But once I have a new story, every step I take is a choice between living the old story or moving towards the new story. And incrementally, I started taking steps towards the new story. I would call a doctor in order to do some research on what kind of surgery he would do. My old story had me calling nobody. My new story encouraged me to meet new people. My old story had me staying alone, and so forth and so on. And I'm happy to say that, as the title of my book is Live the Best Story of Your Life, and I was before living the best story of my life, now I'm living a new best story of my life because I did have the surgery. I went forward in the surgery, and in my first tournament back, I made it to the finals down in Atlanta, actually, at the Atlanta Senior Invitational. And several months later, I made it to the finals of the National. And I then, 2 years later, won two more Nationals. And I've won another couple since then. I met another incredible woman in my life. I got remarried. I moved to Colorado from New York. So I created a story for myself that worked. And how does that fit in with being a tennis player? A junior tennis player, people are telling stories all the time that are not working for them. Like a parent might call me up and say, Billy, you know, he's really good, but when he gets to five all, he chokes. And I say to them, so that's the story that you're telling, right? That's the story you're telling him. Yes. You're telling him he chokes at five all. So that starts to become the way he thinks about things. So when he gets to five all, his brain is like, oh, I always choke. So he's going to do certain things that are going to be called choking. Maybe change his strategy or change his technique or emotionally react differently than he's been reacting. But I say to a parent or a student, what would be a better story than I choke? I know that's what you think you do. That's the story you're telling. But how about a story like this? I see the perceived pressure moments as the sweetest moments in matches. I play for the pressure moments. So when I say that to somebody, of course, they often say to me, but I don't. And my response is, I know you don't. But the story you're telling yourself is not working. So what about if you start telling this new story, even before it's who you are? Start telling the story. Go around to your friends or anybody who will listen or even your parents and say, guess what? There's a new Billy in town. I'm the one who loves pressure points. I love what Billie Jean King said. Pressure is a privilege. That's where I'm going. And to start taking steps in that direction. So an example of that is about 2 weeks ago, I went out to the University of Michigan where I am an alum. I wasn't on the team, but I was called up by the coach out there, Adam Steinberg, who I used to mentor years ago. I mentored him in mental training. Then he went on to be the St. John's coach, and he was the Pepperdine coach where he won national championships, and now he's the Michigan coach. He said, Bob, we're number 24 in the country, and the NCAAs are coming up. Can you come and talk to the kids about stories? So I went out there, and I spent a day with the University of Michigan team, and I talked to them about the power of stories. And I asked them what their story was in the 2 weeks leading up to the NCAA championships. And some of them said, well, you know, everybody graduated last week. We're here on campus. None of our friends are here. I wish I were home. I wish I were already going out to play on the satellite or the challengers. And I said to them, so how's that story working for you in terms of winning the NCAAs as a team? Well, not very well. Well, is there a better story? And together we came up with better stories about where they could be in the week leading up to practice, such as what a great benefit that everybody is cleared out of Ann Arbor so that we are able to bring our full attention to this task of doing great in the national championships. So as a team, they created a new story, which is the week in between the end of school and the national championships is the best week for us to be preparing, rather than it being a bad thing. Individually, we went through the room. There were 11 players on the team and 3 coaches. And each person actually presented some part of their story that wasn't working. The number 2 player had said, well, I get really frustrated when I miss an easy shot. And I get really impatient and I get angry. I say, well, how's that story working for you in winning matches? Well, not very well, but like I've always been that way. Okay, how about a better story? I'm a master of managing frustration. I know, Bob, but I'm not. Okay, but if you were a master of managing frustration, what would you do when you make an error on a shot that you shouldn't make an error on? So he says to me, well, I guess I would take a deep breath. I said, okay, good. So you do know what to do. Why haven't you done it? You've been told it. You're a smart guy. You're a good player. Why haven't you taken that deep breath? Well, I've just always gotten frustrated. Okay, so you've gotten great at getting frustrated. Can you get great at intervening with a deep breath? Same person you are. Practice. Sure. That week, his job was to practice taking a deep breath, which he had always known it, Lisa. But he didn't do it because his story was, I always get frustrated. His new story was, I'm a master of managing frustration. And interestingly, the team gathered around him a lot. If they would be on the adjacent court and they'd see him get frustrated, they'd say, hey, I thought you'd take a deep breath. Oh, yeah, yeah, thanks for reminding me. You know, and he did great in the NCAAs. So we're all able to change stories as long as we see that the way we are really is a story we've told ourselves, even if they're true stories. And the idea of always coming up with a better story, Lisa, I'm going to tell you, it's remarkable. It is so simple. It's so simple that people don't even want to do it. Come up with a better story and move in that direction. So I want to just throw another example in. I mean, I don't know how many people listening are familiar with the movie The Martian. Did you happen to see that, Lisa?
One of my favorite movies of last year. I thought it was phenomenal.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you, I'm sitting in that movie. I love Matt Damon. He always picks good movies, I think. And he's, you know, the background for those who haven't seen it, I won't, you know, this is, I guess, a spoiler alert. I won't spoil it. But basically, the guys, Matt Damon is an astronaut, is left on Mars alone because the other astronauts thought that he had died, and he didn't. There he was on Mars alone. He was screwed, really. I mean, what a bad situation. There's no oxygen. He only had a limited amount of food, and he's alone, and they don't know he's alive. So he is thinking for the first couple of days, well, I mean, I guess I'm done. And then one day he looks into the screen, which was sort of a computer screen, and he looks at all of us in the movie theater, and with a quizzical look, he all of a sudden realized something. And he said, I'm not going to die on Mars. Well, I jammed my wife in the ribs with my elbow, and I said, now there's a story. That is like a crazy story. I mean, how can he say he's not going to die on Mars? He doesn't have enough food to survive. He doesn't have enough oxygen, really. If he goes out, I mean, he needs a limited amount of oxygen. And they're not coming back to save him. But he says, I'm not going to die on Mars. Now, he couldn't solve that in one moment. He couldn't be that and have that happen in one day. But slowly but surely, he solved one problem that would be in front of him. And the first thing he did was he realized if he cut up the food that he had into four parts, he had four times as much food as he thought he had. Now, that didn't mean he was going to survive on Mars. But as he pretty much said at the end of the movie to the young astronauts, you know, someday you may be abandoned in space, but survival can be all about solving one problem at a time. And it was an amazing, amazing example of telling a story that anybody would say, like, I know, but I can't. There's no way. But then he did. He solved each problem that was in front of him. And as somebody who wants to be a master of managing frustration, you start with one deep breath. That's one step. Maybe it becomes enough, something you practice enough so you become that person. And then basically, you are the same as Matt Damon. You're not going to die on Mars. You are going to be the new story. And,
right.
You know, it's an example I give really often. So the power of story is really
example.
Extraordinary.
It's a great example. And I want to clarify for our listeners, Bob, when you say write a new story, you really mean sit down and type it out. I mean, put it to paper and read it often, daily, multiple times a day. And it's kind of that fake it till you make it thing, only your stories include specific action steps. It's not just, you know, some sort of kind of out there, you know, power of positive thinking thing. When you ask somebody to write a story, you want that story to include specific things that they're going to do to achieve the result they're seeking.
Sure. I mean, I can give you a couple of really cool examples, actually. In particular, there was a young boy who was a really great 14 and under player. I mean, he was one of the top players actually in the country. And when I met him and spoke with him on Skype, actually, he told me that there were certain things that were like really just like really bothersome to him that interfered with him playing well. For example, he said, "I hate playing against people that are friends." That was one example. And I said, "So that's the story that you're telling, right? You play a friend, you hate it, and therefore you don't do as well, right?" "Yeah, yeah." I said, "Well, you're one of the best players in the country. Almost everybody you play in an important match is probably going to be a friend, somebody that you've played before and will play again. And just like Andy Murray and Novak Djokovic have played each other since they were 14 years old." I said, "That story about not playing well against friends is not going to help you very much in your career." "I know. What am I supposed to do?" "Okay, so you write a new story." And when I say, again, write, so I have him write down his old story, which includes, "I don't like playing against friends." Or another thing that he had in his story was, "I always make excuses while I'm playing if I'm not doing well." Or, "I always look at the draw and I kind of decide in advance that this is a match I'm going to win or this is a match I can't win." So those would be old story pieces. And I would have him write those things down. So, because when you write down, when you write something down, it gives you more, call it distance, than you have when you just think something, or even when you say it. Because you can look at it, and you can almost look at it as if it's somebody else's story. And I'll tell you something, Lisa, we're great at fixing other people's stories. So if this boy wrote down these three pieces, one, "I don't like playing people, I don't like playing people I know." He writes that down. He looks at it. If it was somebody else's story, he would have an answer for them. And the answer would be a new story, such as, "Hey, when you play people you know their game really well, you can devise a strategy for playing against them. I feel it's a gift to play people that I know really well." So now that's a different story. The power of that story is he starts to use the story to be more effective rather than to hold on to the old story. Or if his story is, "I make excuses," and he looks at that on a piece of paper, it's like, "Yeah, if I knew a friend that made a lot of excuses, what would I tell them to do? Well, maybe I would tell them that tennis matches are loaded with mistakes that are unintentional, that mistakes are part of the game. So maybe I'll be somebody that can shift that story from I make excuses to there are no excuses. Errors are part of the game. I accept that errors are part of the game, and I accept the results with dignity and class." So that would be a story that somebody could then start to work towards. So this particular boy, he shifted these things. He stopped making excuses because he saw that it was just something he had gotten good at. And he could get good at something else, which was, when a match was over, being a good winner or loser. In losing, making no excuses. When shaking hands, saying, "Hey, on another day, a different result, well played." But not making excuses that the court was too slippery, it was too sunny, the sun was in my eyes. My favorite racket, the string broke, no excuses. So his story could simply be, "I make no excuses." So there are specific actions, but more importantly, I think, is that the new story has to be about who somebody aspires to be. So that's why I use the phrase like, "I'm a master at," for example, managing frustration, or "I love the pressure points." That's a way of being. If you love pressure points, then when there is a pressure point, maybe you're going to figure out something that you can do. See, people don't really like to be told what to do. Generally, people are not that good with advice. Otherwise, all these tennis lessons that we would give would be received and acted on instantly. Like to say to a 14-year-old, put your shoulders back after a point. That's really good advice. I mean, why wouldn't somebody just start doing that? And I think it's because junior players in particular, they want to figure things out for themselves. They don't want to be told what to do. And it's almost their function to not listen to adults. They're at a point in their life that they're creating independence. So great advice is often rejected. So in some way, by shifting somebody to be a person, for example, is like, I'm a self-reliant athlete. I know what's really best for my game. I leverage my coaches and my parents. I listen to what they say and factor it into the game that I'm trying to develop. So that they're building in self-reliance, they're building in independence, and they're also using the information as they feel is necessary. One of the things I said to Adam Steinberg, the coach of Michigan, and he's great, and he's a great coach. I said, when you're coaching these guys during the match, and you come over to them and say, hey, move your feet more or be more aggressive, most of the time, what do? He says, well, they don't really listen at that moment. I said, well, have you ever tried having a different story as a coach, which is, as a coach, I ask my players what they need in any moment. He's like, well, what do you mean? I said, when you go over to them in the middle of a match on a changeover, have you ever thought about saying to them, what can I do to help you right now? What do you need to hear from me? And if they say, leave me alone, well, then that's pretty much what they're saying. You may want to give them information, but if they're saying, leave me alone, I don't need anything, don't force feed them. It's not going to help them. And if they say, hey, coach, I need to know what to do strategically, they're asking you. Now when you say to them, go to the backhand more and come up to the net, they're more likely to listen. Does that make sense?
I think that's great advice. Yeah, I think that's great advice. I wish more coaches would utilize that.
Well, the thing is, it's the nature of the industry of coaching to give advice. But we've also seen, unfortunately, that our system of coaching is not working that great, because we're not producing the kinds of players that other countries seem to be producing. And there's a pretty good possibility that the players that are doing the best are the players that have a cooperative sort of equal relationship with their coaches. When you see somebody like Roger Federer hire Stefan Edberg, it's not that he's bringing Stefan Edberg in to tell him what to do. It's a collaboration. They're working together as a team to come up with what's best. If Stefan Edberg suggests to Roger that he did do something, Roger's going to say, well, I'm not sure about that. Maybe I'll give it a try. What do you think about this, though? And it's the same thing with Becker and Nole. I mean, most of us felt like it was a bad fit, that Becker had way too much ego. But Becker, you know, he made recommendations, and it was up to Novak to decide if he wanted to do them or not. So, you know, it would be a wonderful thing if we could start shifting our coaching modality to be one of, it's a collaboration. I made the mistake for years of thinking that the player worked for me. This is what you should do. This is what you need to do. You need to have more top spin. You need to have more of that. But it wasn't that I asked the question of them enough, what do you think? And when I finally realized that I work for the player, my whole teaching model shifted. It became one of listening more than telling. And by listening, I was able to give better input. I could hear my players.
Well, and also, so it puts the onus on the player to self-evaluate, to learn that skill of, you know, really understanding where their shortcomings are, where their strengths are, and being able to articulate that. And, I mean, what a phenomenal skill set to develop.
Well, let's face it. You better be independent, and you better be able to figure things out for yourself, because that is what you have to do when you're playing. There's nobody to tell you what to do. And the most interesting thing is that kids, adults who've taken a lot of lessons, they're not short on the information about what to do. They have so much information that if you leave them alone, there's a fairly good chance they'll come up with the most valuable information that they feel. Right? I mean, think about how many lessons you've taken, Lisa. I mean, I don't know how many that is. But even if it's only five. Yeah, but even if it's only five lessons, you have a lot of information about how to hit a forehand. So in that information are some of the answers. And if the answers are not there, then you reach out to somebody else and say, what kind of information do you have about the forehand? I want more depth. And then you can decide what's working for you. I mean, what do you think for you? I mean, I don't need to put you on the spot, but like for you, what's the most important thing for you in order to play tennis to the level in competition that you are capable of playing? What's the most important thing for you?
For me, it's making sure that I'm having fun out there because that's the level I play, you know, not attaching too much importance to any single point, game, set, or match.
Okay, so your main thing is to be enjoying it, to be happy, and now you go to take a tennis lesson and the emphasis is on technique, not on how do you find real happiness on the court. Right?
Right.
So sometimes you go away on a vacation, you decide to take a lesson with the teaching pro there or the coach, and they immediately start talking about like the way you're standing, the way you're moving. If you were to stop and say, listen, the most important thing for me to play really good tennis is that I'm having a great time. Do you have any input for me? You were a player. Did you have a good time playing? Tell me. Teach me about what I need to hear because I know if I can improve the part about having a good time, I'm going to get a lot of the results that I want. They may not be winning all the time, but I'm going to come off the court and feel rewarded, content, happy. I'm going to go home and tell my kids and my spouse, hey, I had a great time today. You know why? Because I was letting go of each point when it was over. Because that might be the input somebody would give you. If you came to me and said, I want to be happier on the court, I would say, well, okay, here's a couple of things you want to practice. One, accepting that you're not perfect. Being okay with that. Having a short memory. Like forgetting about the last point once it's over, both your good and bad shots. Collaborating with your doubles partner, supporting them, doing what it takes to make them feel good. Being congratulatory to your opponent. I mean, there's a half a dozen or a dozen things that you could do that will help you be happy on the court. And if you're saying the most important thing for me to play good tennis is to be happy, then that's the stuff to be working on. Not your forehand, because again, if your forehand's good and you win, that doesn't mean you're necessarily happy. It means you won, but most of us have found that the win doesn't last that long. I mean, by the time you get home, the win is over. Maybe it lasts for a day. So, if you were to ask me, what's the most important thing for you, Bob, in order to play your best tennis? I mean, I've learned that the answer is, I need to go on the court and just be Bob. I need to be myself. If I try and be a better version of Bob while I'm playing, I usually play worse. In other words, if I try and have a better forehand than I've got, I usually crack up more. So I needed to work on how can I just be Bob on the court? Well, one way was to accept the fact that errors happen in tennis. They're part of the game. I needed to be able to work on this idea of acceptance. For me to be Bob, I needed to reduce my self-judgment. For me to be Bob, I needed to be okay with winning or losing. For me to be Bob, I needed to have dignity in class when I would complete a match. So those are the things I would work on, and I would go on the court. I'd be free of the concerns of winning and losing. And if I was just Bob, I won more. It's like, oh, look at that. I won another national. How did I do that? Well, I was myself. I wasn't trying to be something else. So most people that I meet, if I say to them, for you to be your best, what do you need? And they might say, I need to be more focused. Okay, how do you practice being focused? Well, maybe you do some sort of mindfulness training every day. Maybe you go walk in nature. I just heard recently that Novak Djokovic, people don't know this about him, but he spends a lot of time in nature. He looks at the stars. He walks in the woods. And why does he do it? Because it gives him perspective about how really important is what he's doing. I mean, he's the best player in the world. I mean, he's like world-renowned. He's the athlete of the year, sportsman of the year. But by being in nature, he realizes that what he does is not that big in the whole scheme of things. So think about how that reduces pressure for him. He doesn't need to be the biggest, best in the world because he can't be. The world is too big. So now he becomes a better player in pressure situations because he knows how big the universe is. He sees the stars. He sees that he's small. And it's a really cool thing to know that our very best player balances all of his physical training with being in nature. How many of our kids are spending time in nature, as an example, to realize that this one tennis match is not the end of the world? It's not the biggest thing. How many of our parents put into perspective that playing in the 12s is a small part of their son or daughter's life, and that putting so much magnification on it probably works against them doing well? So if our,
well,
if our top player is out
I,
in nature, yeah, go, I'm sorry.
I was going to say, sorry, I think, you know, you just hit on a really key point there, Bob, that a lot of this starts with us, the parents, and keeping our own perspective in terms of what one tournament, one match, one day of practice actually means long term for our children. And the answer is it doesn't mean a whole heck of a lot. It's one day, one match, one tournament. And we need to practice that perspective building so that we can then model it and teach it to our children.
Yeah. Hey, let's not forget what Wayne Bryan used to say to his kids, that being Mike and Bob Bryan, the greatest doubles team in the history of tennis. They played a lot of tennis as junior players, and they were doing that road trip every weekend, driving here, there, or everywhere. And when they would finish playing, they were so excited about their match, and all they wanted to do was talk about it, talk about it. And Wayne Bryan, when they would come off the court, he'd look at them, and they all they wanted to do was talk about the match. And he would say, like, so, pasta or pizza? And they were like, what? Yeah. We just spent the whole weekend driving to some other state for you to play a tournament. We stood around all day watching you play matches all weekend. It's enough. This is not the only thing in the world. Let's figure out what we're going to have for lunch now, all right? And he wouldn't really even talk about their tennis with them. It was enough. The idea of them being like, them magnifying this experience into being the only thing would have created a distortion and created so much pressure on them every single time they played. And he was a master of reducing that pressure. So, you know, the modesty that a player, that those players had, or the great story about Uncle Tony, Nadal and Rafa going into a chiropractor's office in Paris during the French Open one year. And of course, Rafa was like, he was a god in Paris because of winning every year. He had some neck thing going on. So they made an appointment. They go to the chiropractor's office. The waiting room is packed to see this chiropractor. And Rafa walks in, and the reception people say, oh, Mr. Nadal, no problem. Come right in. And Uncle Tony goes, no. Rafa waits like everybody. He waits in the waiting room because someday he will not be Rafa, the tennis champion. He will just be Rafael Nadal, another person. And you think about how extraordinary that is, that modesty was always being like pushed into Rafa Nadal. That he's just another person. And I can tell you, like, my own personal experience, the day I was in Perth when I won the World Championships. And when I won the World Championships, the representatives for the ITF came up to me and said, hey, when the rankings come out on March 1st, you're number one in the world. Well, I was like, I was all over myself. I was so excited, number one in the world, it's really cool, whatever. And then a few days later, when I was back here in the United States and people were like, oh, my God, that's amazing, you're number one in the world, I started saying to people, you know, it is a really cool thing, but just don't forget, I had a good year. I played a good tournament. I got that ranking, but I am not the best tennis player I can be. When you get that top rating, all it is a temporary rating on what you did for the last few months or the last year. But to me, my work as a tennis player really began when I was number one in the world. That's when I started to become really a better overall person player. It opened that door for me.
Well, and I think that's a huge message, Bob. Yeah, that's a huge message. And I think, I mean, I know I was guilty of, you know, over-pressuring, over-importantizing rankings and results, you know, for my child coming up through the juniors. And it really came back to bite both of us, you know, in the long run. Luckily, my son's recovered from that in his
sure.
19 years in my home now that he's been out on his own for a year. But I think it's a huge message for parents to hear that, you know, in the moment, it's so easy to get caught up and, oh, my gosh, my kid's the number one seed in the tournament. Or even more, oh, my gosh, my kid just beat the number one seed in the tournament, you know, and has achieved this high-level ranking and yada, yada, yada. But I love your point that should be the time at which you start to really put in the hard work. That's your jumping-off point for being the best you can be. It's not the end point. It's not where you finish. And I think that's a great lesson.
Yeah.
We are coming up on the end of our hour. Bob,
okay.
We're coming up on
sure.
the end of our hour, so I really want to give you the opportunity to give some specifics about how listeners can reach out to you, how they can get your book, and any other last thoughts you would like to leave us with.
Oh, sure. That's good. I appreciate that. Well, my book comes out May 31st. It's called Live the Best Story of Your Life, A World Champion's Guide to Lasting Change. It's for sports. It's for business. It's for life in general. And life specifically, anything that you want to shift or change, this book can help you. It's a very simple method, and there's also 33 actual, I call them private coaching sessions that are in it that help you along the way. It's available on Amazon.com. It's available on BarnesandNoble.com. It's being published by Hatherly, which is a division of Random House. Very, very excited about it. My website is boblitwin.com. You can get information about me there, how to contact me is available there. If you're on Facebook, if you like my page, it's called facebook.com/boblitwinauthor. That would be great, really help me get the book out there. I'm very excited about it. I appreciate the opportunity to share that information. And Lisa, it's always really great to talk with you. And I guess the last thing I want to say is that Lisa and I met at Tennis Congress in Atlanta a few years ago. And if you've never heard of the Tennis Congress, please go to their website and check it out. It's one of the most remarkable tennis experiences I've ever had. I'm on the faculty. The athletes who go to it, recreational athletes, walk away from it seeing tennis in a whole different way. It's not tennis camp. It's just a remarkable experience, and please check it out. So that's all I have to say.
I
hope you
that.
All get to live the best story of your life. Yeah. Sorry, what?
That's awesome, Bob. And for my listeners, too, we'll have a link to Bob's website, to his new book. And so if you didn't get that, just take a look on our books page or on our links page, and you'll be able to find Bob as well. And Bob, I just want to say thank you so much for being with us. I know it's early where you are in Colorado, and I so appreciate you getting up and sharing your time and your knowledge with us. And to my listeners, I hope you've learned something today. I really am a firm believer in Bob's approach to storytelling and how storytelling can impact the way we view our lives and the way we live our lives. So, Bob, again, thank you so much. Best of luck with the new book, and I hope to have you back on the show again soon.
Thank you so much, Lisa. I really enjoy it, and hope that I covered your voice for you by overspeaking. So thanks a lot. Hope you all live the best story of your lives every single day. Be well, everybody.
Thanks so much, Bob. And to my listeners, thank you. We'll see you next week on Parenting Aces.
Hey, man, did you hear? Your favorite Mighty Wings are back at McDonald's.
Say what?
Yeah, man. We should...
Word.
Yeah, man, that's what I was saying.
Wait, no joke. You serious right now? Are you for real, real, not for play?
Dude, are you done? Because if you're done, we can go get some.
Yeah, let's bro.
Yeah, let's do it.
Get excited. Mighty Wings are back at McDonald's. Pair a 5-piece with fries and a frozen strawberry lemonade and get your Mighty Wings fixed before they're gone again. At participating McDonald's for a limited time.